Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
My God. Great. Today, indeed, we are fortunate to have an air chief, a person who has ruled the skies of the country, to be with us, not alone, but to the strength, his strength, which he has, which has seen him through, that is his lady wife, Mrs. Madhubala Naik. Sir, may I now request you to kindly tell our young people what they should become and draw a few lessons from your life. Over to Air Chief Marshal Pradeep Naik.
As you may have realized, I have heard of people like Peter Drucker and Adam Smith and, you know, your McGregor and Maslow, about which you will learn. I am not a management guru. I am not an actor. I am not a politician. I am not a cricket player. I am nothing. I just had the privilege of commanding the Indian Air Force, the fourth largest air force in the world. But that was also many years back. So I keep asking myself, why me? Why do these people call me, you know, to talk to you all? What is my qualification? Yeah, I have one qualification, as has been brought out. I have two children, two boys. One is a wing commander, flyer in the Air Force, and one is a captain in the Merchant Navy. So while they were growing up, you know, I was with them at every stage of their growing up. I was offering them advice at every stage, what to do, what not to do, and how to go about things and things like that. So that is one. Both of them are doing very well now. No, I think I'll let you into a small secret. Not one of them listened to even a word of advice from me. So I'm not qualified to advise you all also. What I thought was, I'll share some of my thoughts with you all. You know, some of the things that have stood me in good stead over my 42 odd years with the Indian Air Force and the rest of the life also. So I thought I'll just share some of these things with you. You see, now at the end of your 2-year tenure here, some of you will look for campus placements. Some of you, quite a majority of you, will be searching for jobs. A few of you will join your dad's business. And few, very, very few, would go for higher studies. But there is one common thread that will be running through all these people. You know, when we came to face, after our studies, to face the wicked, wicked world, we were like unsuspecting virgins. Nobody told us what, and we got, what is the parliamentary word for, surprised. We got nicely and properly surprised. Aim is that you all shouldn't get surprised. So there's one common thread that runs through all these people. And that common thread is people, the unwashed masses of the country, large variety of people expect a lot more from you now. Till now, you are in what is called Vidyarthi Dasha, in thirst of knowledge, in search of knowledge. After you graduate from here, you are going to be in jobs, you are going to be facing real life into the bad, bad world. People expect more from you. They'll hold you more accountable and more responsible for your actions. All this time, you could blame it on your parents sometimes, maybe your professors sometimes, maybe the curriculum, maybe the education system. After that, no. You'll have to face life and you will be held more accountable for your actions. So keep this in mind. This is one thing that you should be ready to face. Don't let it come as a surprise like it did for most of us. So the first thing that you need to keep in mind is that life is not fair. I'm sure some of you would have already realized that. But keep this in mind, so far, if you studied well, you got good marks, you got a pat on the back. If you did badly, you did not get it. It was a straightforward equation. When you go to actually work for somebody, when you're working in a firm or your first job or whatever, you may feel that you're doing very well and you deserve a pat on the back. But it may so happen that your neighbor will get the pat on the back. May happen. You know, you feel so, you've done so well, and you've done so well for your company or the organization that you're working for, that you definitely deserve a promotion. But some Charlie sitting over there will get the promotion. You know he's bad. You know he's nowhere near you. But he is the nephew of the boss. So he just might get the promotion. You feel that you deserve a raise. Somebody else might get it who you feel is brain dead. But he might get the raise instead of you. Now this is something that you need to be prepared for. Life is not fair. Be prepared for that. Otherwise, when it happens the first time, you feel very disgusted. You feel very demoralized. Your efficiency suffers. And it might set you into a downward slide. So watch out for that. The second thing to know is the relationship between success and failure. You know, you have a coin, toss it, success, failure. Two sides of the same coin. They have a very symbiotic relationship. Now, who does not want success? Everybody wants success. Success is a good thing. You must try for it at all times. When you're successful, people laugh at you, people smile with you, they give you a pat on the back, a lot more girls look at you, a lot more boys look at you, you know, the other way around. When you're successful, everybody wants to be successful. My suggestion is treat success with a bit of caution. Ek toh it is transient. It just passes away, you know, fades away like anything before you realize it. The second thing is, it breeds complacency. All of you are familiar with our Indian cricket team. At least the boys would be familiar. Thank you. They win the first match, become complacent, and lose the rest of the series. Very common. Why? Because of complacency. Why? Because of success going to your heads. So treat success with a bit of caution. Now the other side of the coin is failure. Failure, I think, teaches you much more. You know, it makes you look inwards, find out what the faults are, at least it should, and try a new approach. The first thing is, you should try and improve yourself. Try again and try again. Do not give up. Do not be afraid of failure. If you are afraid of failure, what will happen is you might get into something called a zero error syndrome. You all must have heard of this. Zero error syndrome means you're so scared that on your watch, there should be no mistake, that you don't trust any of your subordinates. You don't delegate enough. So you land up in grief and the whole organization suffers. So don't land up in zero error syndrome. Even if you fail, try again and try again, you will succeed ultimately. So the basic way to deal with success and failure, my humble suggestion, is treat success with humility and treat failure with dignity. This is the way to address these two issues. Now we come to a great trait called professional knowledge. Professional knowledge is something that one must have and you cannot do without. And the way to professional knowledge in any profession, be it military, corporate or anywhere, the way to professional knowledge is through hard work. There is no other shortcut to gaining professional knowledge. When you join your new job or your first job, you must aim to make yourself the tops in that profession. You must get yourself right up there so that people come to you. People ask you for things to do. You know, you should be that good as far as your own professional knowledge is concerned. Not only learning, but application of that knowledge. People should come to you. You should become indispensable to the system. The second thing is to love the job that you have. If you can do that, then the job becomes a pleasure. But for that, you may have to search for the correct job, maybe 2-3 places. Once you find the correct job, like in my case, when I got commissioned, my job was to do fighter flying, which I used to love. And it was never a job, it was a pleasure. I mean, day and night, any day, we could just do flying. That was good in the junior years. So, love your job. Then it becomes a pleasure. There is no substitute for hard work, especially in the initial part of your career. I'm sorry, but that's the way the cookie crumbles. There are many people who try and take shortcuts by lagaing patti and all that, but it doesn't work for too long. So, in your initial part of your career, be prepared for hard work to acquire professional knowledge. I must share a little parable with you. You know what's a parable, I think? Everybody knows. There was a farm, you know, normal farm, animals, birds. There was a farmer there, and there were trees and all those things. In this farm, there was an eagle who used to sit on the tallest tree. Majestic bird. And used to easily sun himself and aram se baithta tha. And once, whenever he felt like doing it, he used to do a sortie, majestic flight and come back and sit down. Royal life. So there was a rabbit, you know, down below, who used to keep looking at him. He said, yeah, that is the life I must lead him. How to do that? So one day he built up his courage and went up to that eagle. He said, sir, may I ask you a small question? He said, yeah, go ahead. So he said, sir, can I also lead the type of life that you are leading? So the eagle told him, why not? Yeah, India is a free country. Go have a ball. Live like, you know, whatever you want to. So next day the rabbit decided. He came out with two comfortable pillows, one novel, and a soft drink bottle with him. At the bottom of the tree, put one leg on top of the other and started reading a book, enjoying himself. One fox was passing by, you know, Lomdi. Passing by, he was a little hungry. He saw this rabbit sitting there, you know, he said, my God, my breakfast. He jumped on him and ate him up. So, the moral of the story is that in the corporate world, if you want to enjoy yourself or in any organization, please ensure that you are sufficiently high up. Only then you can put their feet up. If you're down below, somebody will jump and eat you up. That is the moral of the story. So, no substitute for hard work. Next, I'd like to discuss time management. I think today onwards, you all must have realized, in fact, from 8th onwards, that time management is very, very critical. Time is a resource which is awfully short in life. At present, you are single. You know, after a couple of years, when you start doing a job, when you go out into the world, you will grow up, you will get married, you will have children, you will have a flat, you will have a car. You know, your zone of interest is expanding all the way. As you rise in the hierarchy of your job, higher the job, bigger the span of control, by and large. So what happens is, you have to share your time. Time becomes very, very critical. So, you need to set your priorities right from the word go. Allocate time slots and then work. First thing to do is do not push on to tomorrow what you can do today. Do not be like Hamlet, the prince. Procrastination was the word that he coined that time. Delay, delay, delay. Do not do that. Do it now. You know, one of the mottos of those sports companies, do it now. Only then can you survive. Otherwise, time will overrun you and it makes things very, very difficult. So, managing time is very, very important. Now, I come to a very important point. Decision making. It's one of the most important qualities of leadership, both in the civil life as well as in the military life. There are so many times you may have seen a simple act of placing a chair in the drawing room or on the stage. Your boss tells you, put it here. Then he looks at it, he says, nahin, yaar, thoda idhar, thoda udhar. No, get another chair, you know, like that. Dilly-dallying, not taking a decision. The moment you defer taking a decision, or the moment you dilly-dally, it affects the entire organization. You see, in normal life also, as well as in more so in military life, your decisions are generally taken without full information being available. They are taken under conditions of uncertainty. The moment that happens, you're waiting for the results. What I suggest is a decision needs to be taken, whether right or wrong. The trick is to take right decisions all the time. And what helps you with that? Your professional knowledge and experience, tajurba. It helps hell of a lot as far as decision making is concerned. And in fact, there is no replacement for experience. The moment you experience, the moment you have good professional knowledge, your decision making improves. And it improves the entire organization along with that. Sometimes you have to trust the gut feeling. And good gut feeling comes out of good experience, comes out of good professional knowledge. Every time you don't have to trust your gut feeling, but don't ignore it every time also. It is a chance that you have to take. Decision making is most vital. In the corporate world, taking a bad decision, not taking a decision at all, leads to loss of profits. In the military, it leads to loss of lives. Decision making is very, very vital. Now, let's talk a little bit about stress. You all know what is stress. All of you, I think, considerably stressed out by now. Little bit of stress is always good. It improves your performance. But excessive stress, stress that you are unable to handle, reduces your efficiency to zero. And your value to the organization becomes zero. It leads to things like suicides and all in extreme cases. Stress is, excessive stress is bad. And what causes stress, three of the main things that cause stress is lack of time management, lack of professional knowledge, and lack of decision taking. Three of the biggest things that cause you stress. Now, how to manage stress, I think all of you know better than I do. There is pranayam, there is yoga, there is music, there are hobbies. All these things, meditation, all these things are there to manage stress. There are counselors who advise. There are friends who can look after you. In a stressful situation, let me suggest to you, perspective is very important. You know what I mean by perspective? In real life, you close one eye, put your finger in front of the other eye. You'll only see the finger. You won't see anything else. Now, as you move the finger a little bit away, you will start seeing more and more. So, what happens is, when you are a working body, you are very close to a problem. So, your perspective has dropped. You need to go away a little bit, view the problem from that distance, and you will generally find that you come to some kind of a solution. And your stress level reduces. So, perspective, keeping perspective in mind, is very important for managing stress, besides all these other things. Now, just a wee bit of a mention of something called tact. Tango, Alpha, Charlie, Tango. T-A-C-T. Tact is the facility of saying the correct thing at the correct time. It is also a facility of saying nothing at all at times. You know, tact is very, very important. You can be trained to develop tact. Some of the things that I am talking about, you cannot be trained for them. But tact is one thing you can train yourself for. Keep that in mind. As you rise higher in the hierarchy, tact becomes more and more important. It diffuses many situations. I would like to share a story with you. You know, in Pune, there is a place called Shanwarwada. Yeah, you know, fantastic. I have not been there. I want to go. And where the Peshwas used to stay. And we had a very great Peshwa called Madhurao. Madhurao Peshwa was a great Peshwa. So one day he was walking from his living quarters to the Darbar. And there are a lot of people going around here, there, all around, you know. Lot of people there. So he was passing everybody and everybody was doing that Muzra, as we call it. Madhurao, when he used to dress up, on his pug he used to wear a turra of pearls. Moti ka turra. Now, that day, that turra was a little askew, tida, little bit. Now, everybody was looking at it, but nobody had the guts to tell him anything, you know. So he was walking like that to the Darbar. When my young Bisti, water carrier, was passing by, he stopped. A lot of people around. He stopped and said, Sarkar, may I? So he said, yeah, what's it? He said, Sarkar, aapka turra jara teda hai. So Madhurao didn't look at him again. He said the turra right and walked to the Darbar. After the Darbar was over, Madhurao sent for this fellow, Bisti. First, he ordered 20 lashes to this fellow. And thereafter, he gave him 10 villages as a jagir. So why those 20 lashes? Lack of tact. He pointed out Peshwa's mistake in front of all the others. No tact. So he got 20 lashes. And for his loyalty in pointing out this mistake, he got 10 villages as jagir. Both things are important. We'll come to loyalty a little later. But tact is important as you grow up in life. This brings me to a connected issue, sense of humor. Vital for stress reduction. It is vital for diffusing awkward situations. Sense of humor. Point is not to become a joker yourself. People should be laughing with you and not laughing at you. We Indians, you all will agree, are unnecessarily serious people. You know, we refuse to laugh at ourselves. We must learn to laugh at ourselves and not treat everything seriously. You know, we need to do that as a country. Now, in my opinion, sense of humor is an art. Either you are born with it, either you got it or you ain't got it. I don't think it can be developed. So you are lucky if you have a sense of humor. Like, I know thousands of jokes, yeah, but I remember them only half an hour after the occasion has passed, you know. Tough luck. So if you are born with sense of humor, you have an added advantage as far as your future life is concerned. It makes for very good working relationship, you'll agree. Sense of humor. Now we come to a very important issue, the last issue I wish to discuss. Courage. Courage. There are two kinds of courage, physical courage and mental courage, moral courage. Physical courage, I think all of us feel that we have physical courage, but you never realize it till such time as you come to that situation, till such time as you're faced with that situation. You never know whether you got courage, physical courage or no. For example, I'll give you a simple example. You're traveling in a bus and you find four boys or four men troubling a girl, chhedkhani kar rahe. Tough chaps, them also. Will you have the courage to stop them or will you keep quiet, wait for somebody else to take the initiative? Physical courage. Let's say an attacking dog, do you have the courage to step in and stop him from, you know, tearing somebody apart? That is physical courage. There are no guidelines for this. I'll tell you a story. We had a coursemate, a colleague of ours actually, very handsome, tall, very good in games, very good in studies, very good in all kinds of things. Well-spoken, good sense of humor, everything was good about it, good in sports. And he had a line of girlfriends, you know, ringing him up and looking and, you know, things. We all used to envy him. You know, we said, yeah, must become like him. He was our role model. The 71 war started. And we all were flying missions. He chickened out. You know, in the sense, he wouldn't fly. If he went to him, he would cry. And it's a very embarrassing thing. He chickened out. It happens. In war or faced with a certain situation, you suddenly realize that you are lacking courage. It happens. So we also protected him, we treated him. Of course, he's left. After some time, he left the Air Force. But this is what happens. So you don't know if you have whether you have physical courage or no, unless you are faced with that situation. The second is moral courage. Now, moral courage is something that you can develop. And it's a very, very important attribute, a very good leadership attribute. Moral courage means having the courage of your convictions. You have to stand up for what is right. You have to go in the right direction. You have to follow the right things, regardless of what the others are doing. That is moral courage. Moral courage is something that you can develop. So physical courage is something that you may have, you may not have, but you wish that you have. And moral courage is something that you must train and develop. Now, in the end, I'd like to talk about three things that have stood me in very good stead all this while. Honesty, integrity, and loyalty. By honesty, I do not mean honesty in terms of money. No, no, no. Honesty in terms of money is the lowest form of honesty, I call, because there are so many checks and balances, there are so many auditors, there are so many people watching you. You cannot do cheating unless you're Vijay Mallya or some, you know, high level sort of a guy. You can't do much as far as money is concerned. So that's not the type of honesty that I'm talking about. Honesty in self-appraisal. When you look at yourself in the mirror in the morning, can you appraise yourself honestly? Or do you see a handsome young man or a beautiful young woman over there in the mirror? Can you honestly appreciate your weaknesses? What are your weak points? What are your strong points? Honestly, be honest to yourself. That is one honesty. Honesty in appraising your friends. Initially, I think there is a jingle somewhere, Hare Dost Zaruri Hota Hai, something like that. No, one of these chaps. Huh? But it's not so. Later on, you will realize that every friend is not a good friend. Do you have the honesty to appraise your friends also, without prejudice? That kind of honesty. Do you have the honesty to offer honest opinion? Do you have the honesty to offer honest advice? The other guy may not like it. It may be your boss. But do you have the honesty to do that? That is the kind of honesty I mean. It's a good quality to have. It reduces problems. It helps you sleep aram se in the night. No problems. The next quality that is very important is integrity. Integrity means practice what you preach. Integrity means do not stab your friends in the back if the occasion so demands. Integrity means the courage of your convictions. Now, the last point I come to is loyalty. Loyalty is very, very vital, especially in the military. You cannot live without loyalty. You cannot fight without loyalty. But even in the corporate world, loyalty to your organization, loyalty to your team, loyalty to your friends is very, very vital. That is what gets things going. If you do not have loyalty, things will not function. Loyalty begets loyalty. Now, in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, I envy you, because you are going to grow at such a time when your country is going places. India is definitely going places, regardless of all the nonsense that you keep hearing every day in the newspapers and the media. There is no stopping our country. We are the only ones who can stop it. In 20 odd years, 10 years I would say, by about 2030, thereabouts, your economy is going to be the third largest economy in the world. Your infrastructure is going to be paralleling any of the other developed countries. What you need to do is to be a good citizen. What you need to do, boys and girls, is to contribute to nation building. You know, the time of our generation is over now. We are on the decline. It is your generation that has to bring this nation up. And I'm quite positive that out of the people who are sitting here, I'm sure there'll be leaders in your profession from this particular crowd itself. I'm quite positive. Since you're going to be leaders of your profession, I'd like to end with another small parable. We had the same farm. You know, the farmer was there and there were animals and birds, trees, That same eagle was there sitting on top, you know, of the tallest tree and flying away whenever he wanted. Majestic flight. Now, this time, instead of the rabbit, there was a turkey. You know that turkey we have for Christmas? Turkey bird, it can't fly much. So, his problem was is to look at the eagle soaring away into the skies and say, why can't I fly like that fellow? So, one day he tried, he had no energy in his wings, you know. So, 7-8 feet and he plonked on the ground. He was very sad, disgusted with himself. Moping around, there was a bull on the farm, you know, a tough, proper bull, as your picture, a bull to be. He came to him and said, brother, what's wrong with you? Why are you so sad? So he said, brother, I can't fly like that eagle. I don't just have the energy to fly like him. So he thought for some time and he told him, see, many people have told me that my droppings carry a lot of nutrients, you know. Why don't you try it out? So turkey was desperate. He just wanted to fly. So he said, okay, I'll try. So next day, he saw the bull's droppings, rolls himself into them, very warm, probably imbibed a little bit of that also. He found he had got energy. So next day, he tried flying. He flew about 10 feet. End of the week, he could fly about 25, 30 feet into the air, which was all very good. And he kept this bull's dropping treatment constant. At the end of the month, finally, he was confident that he could fly. And that day, he decided to fly and he flew majestically and sat on top of a tall tree. The farmer came out, you know, looking around all over. He suddenly saw that turkey sitting on top of the tree. He said, what the hell is that guy doing there? So he went inside, picked up his shotgun, came out and shot that turkey. Plack, he fell down. So what is the moral of the story? Bullshit can take you to the top, but it cannot sustain you there. Yeah. With that, I come to the end of my talk. Thank you very much for your patience.
Hello, sir. My name is Swati. My question to you is, like, as being a defense person, you have a 24/7 job. You don't have, like, you don't have a timing of 8 to 10 or 8 to 9. So, how you used to manage your time for this 24/7 thing?
Thank you, Swati. Very difficult. But, you know, I must share this. Now, of course, I am retired. Enough time. Even now, you don't have too much time here because you got to do housework and all that, you know. You got to help your wife and whatever. No. You know, one day one of my friends came when I was the chief. The chief has a very nice office, you know, in Vayu Bhavan. And he's got probably the best view in Delhi. I'm sure Arun sir will agree. You look down at Vijay Chowk and you got North Block and South Block and Rashtrapati Bhavan visible like that. Beautiful office on the fifth floor. So one of my friends wanted to come and visit me. We hadn't met for a long, long time. So I said, okay, aajao. Now that particular day, we sat and we discussed old times, then we had a cup of coffee, then bachchi. It was going on how old friends, you know, when you meet. For 2 or 3 hours or 4 hours, we spoke and we forgot how the time was passing by. And imagine, not a single telephone call. Not a single call from Raksha Mantri or anything. Not a single file came into my office. He said, yaar, tum to majhe marte ho, you know, it's really good. So, there are some days like that, but very few. Otherwise, you are, you know, just rushing from place A to place B. Of course, you have a lot of help. So, delegation is important for time management. Allotting priorities is very important. Which is most important? Which is time critical? Which is more time critical? It needs a very deep insight. It needs professional knowledge to manage your time actually. The moment you have that, you can bajao city, you know, there's no problem, really. But professional knowledge is very important. Knowledge of the environment around you is very important. What's happening? Who's good? Who's bad? Knowledge of how to delegate is very important. You delegate jobs to a duffer, It will make your job more difficult. You must delegate properly as per the person's capability. All these things are involved in, you know, time management. So that's it. I mean, that's the best answer I can give.
Sir, what kind of leadership style do you believe in? A commanding leader who listens to people, a commanding leader who knows what is good for the team, or a communicative leader who listens to people and resolves every single conflict among team, even though it is not relevant to common goal?
What do I look like?
I don't know, sir.
Bolo na.
You might be a commanding leader.
Thank you. Very nice question, really. You know, there are, not leaving aside this question, there are three reasons why one asks questions. First is to show off your own knowledge. Second is to show off that speaker's ignorance. And third is genuine thirst for knowledge. So I think I put this in the third category. Very good question. I feel I am one of the best leaders in the world. I think it's others who should say what kind of a leader I am. I mean, that's the best I can do. But yes, I did listen to people. I do believe in participative decision making. I do believe in delegation. I do believe in giving credit where credit is due. I do believe in the danda also when it is due.
On behalf of Sri Balaji Society, I express my profound gratitude to our guest, Air Chief Marshal Pradeep Vasant Naik, PVSM, VSM, Sir, for sparing his valuable time and guide us for a successful career. Sir, we are greatly encouraged by your gracious presence and immensely benefited by your inspiring ideas, especially about treating success with humility and accepting failures with dignity. Also leading a life with honesty, integrity and loyalty. And sir, we all will do our level best to be the good citizens and contribute to nation building. I would now also like to thank our beloved Bala sir for his guidance and providing us such a stimulating and learning environment. Thank you.